Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bone Swans by C.S.E. Cooney. Narrated by C.S.E. Cooney. This collection is dedicated to John O'Neill and Tina Jens. Introducing C.S.E. Cooney by Jean Wolfe. Picture me sitting in a small used bookshop with a banana cream pie on my lap. The young man reading at the lectern has given us a short story that is certainly publishable and has now launched upon one that is not. We have had the poetry that suggests a poor article in Reader's Digest cut up into uneven lengths and the heart-wrenching personal memoir of the sister of a soldier killed overseas. And others. You know. The readers are kept in order by Claire Cooney, a startling young blonde with a smile capable of lighting up a good-sized theater. At last she reads herself, a poem that rhymes and scans and grabs you from the opening line. The hero is a disfigured corpse floating down a city sewer, and it is funny when it is not horrible. And sometimes when it is. She chants it, and her voice is clear and musical. I couldn't be prouder of her if I were her father. I met Claire when my friend Rory Cooney brought her around to see me. His daughter wrote, he explained, and he felt she had talent. Would I be willing to coach her a bit? I read some short pieces she had written and promised to do it. She was 18 at the time. Most writers begin by imitating some favorite author. H.P. Lovecraft imitating Lord Dunsany, for example. There's nothing wrong with that, provided the beginner grows out of it and finds his or her own voice. If Claire began by imitating somebody, she had already grown a long way out of it at 18. She wrote pure Claire Cooney. Try to define that when you finished the stories in this book. She is in love with literature and the theater. Yes, both at the same time. She had a double major in college and has had a double major in life. She has played Rosalind in a professional production of As You Like It, and I wish I could have seen it. If there was ever a girl created by God to swagger around on stage with a broadsword pushed through the knot in her sword belt, Claire is that girl. The one time I have seen her in a play, she was a South African whore. She was good in that role, too, and gave me the impression that she would be good in any role that did not require her to die coughing up blood. What did she learn from me? Nothing, really. There is a select type of student, rare but invaluable, who will certainly succeed if not run down by a truck. You help yourself instead of helping them, putting an arm around their shoulders, and making them promise to say you taught them all they know. I have had two of those, and Claire is one. I tried. I explained to her that there is no money in poetry anymore. She continues to write poetry any time she feels like it. It's all good, and some of it is great. I explained that though writers learned to write by writing short stories, the money was in novels these days. Claire insists she has a secret novel she is grinding away at. Meanwhile, she shows tourists through an aquarium, answers casting calls, and pens poems. Not to mention short stories starring cunning were-rats. And on rare occasions, she writes emails to me. I explained the business of... Well, never mind. You get the picture. Also, this one actually took... I introduced her to science fiction conventions. To the best of my memory, her first was ReaderCon. Always start at the top. Claire, Rosemary, and I lived in Greater Chicago in those dim, far-off days. ReaderCon, as you may know, is always held in or around Boston. We drove. It used to be that Rosemary would spell me at the wheel. By the time we drove to Boston, she was unable to walk more than a step or two, and completely incapable of driving. so Claire spelled me, letting me for the first time ever ride in my own back seat. She would, I'm sure, have worn a chauffeur's cap, had I had wit enough to obtain one. Doubtless you know that once upon a time the very best cars, my father remembered them, had run by steam. The chauffeur did not drive them. He stoked the fire under the boiler. Now I was the chauffeur in the original sense, stoking our fire by encouraging Claire, praising her skill at the wheel, and so forth. Giving her confidence, too, by keeping the road atlas open on my lap, and explaining that soon we would leave this federal highway and enter the other interstate. Claire held our speed between 50 and 55, so that our progress resembled that of a barge on a canal. I was tempted to climb out a window and ride on the roof, ducking for low bridges like the passengers in the song. But though that might have been fun, it would almost certainly have resulted in the loss of the road atlas. I remained inside. Claire did lots of other things, too. When I was locked in an elevator on the first floor of a large motel, and Rosemary marooned in her wheelchair on the second, Claire served as go-between, running up and down the stairs to check the condition of the elevator and report to Rosemary. When we got to ReaderCon, Claire discovered a coven of witches and joined at once. "Keep Halloween in your heart all year long." She fit right in. And before the con was over, the witches were boasting about their new member. Nobody had smartphones then, but Claire and I had brought our cell phones. Claire, I should explain, pushed Rosemary's wheelchair from time to time and was able to accompany and assist her in the ladies' room. On one occasion, Claire and I held a long conference by cell phone before I discovered that Claire was around the corner about 5 short steps away. Perhaps you feel that I have told you too much about the author in this introduction and not enough about the stories in this book. All right, let's take up a favorite of mine, the Big Baja. Perhaps you know that you and I live in the Milky Way galaxy, an immense whorl of stars. You may also know that for years, astronomers have wondered whether our own stars orbiting planets were unique. Did other stars have planets too? A few said yes, and many more no. But no one actually knew. It was all guesswork. Science fiction and religion sided with the minority, the scientific world in general with the majority. Without evidence, it was foolish to assume that anything existed. To assume that things as large as planets did was the height of folly. Now we have a little hard data, and it would appear so far that planets are the rule, not the exception. Let's think about that. The number of stars in our galaxy is enormous, almost infinite. And yet, our galaxy is only one of many. We continue to find new ones, and it may well be that their number is infinite, or nearly. Enter Claire. If there are so many galaxies, and so many stars in each of those galaxies, almost every imaginable race must also exist. What about a race similar to our clowns? A race wearing oversized shoes and rubber noses? Why, there are stranger customs right here on Earth. We know, then, what their society would be like. But what about their religion? And what if their religion were true? God is infinite. Life on the Sun, for Mir and Kiri. That was the day the sky went dark. No eclipse was scheduled on the priests' calendars to spur the fervent into declaiming the last days. No dust storm had blown up from the Belisar wasteland, spinning the air into needle and amber, and suffering all unwary walkers the death of 1,000 cuts. No warning, just the dark. Outside the gates of Rocmoris, a white sun blazed. Rattlesnake basked. Sandwolf slunk to fit inside the meager shadow of a sorrow cactus. Inside the gates, blackness. Frost glistened on brick, boardwalk, dirt path, temple column. Quiet canals formed ice at the banks. Olive branches silvered and verde bushes withered. And each blood-pink bougainvillea shed its papery petals to show the thorns. In the hottest, driest month of the year, to the hottest, driest city in the empire of the open palm, a long and endless winter night had come. Fa'izif ban Ajur and his army of childless men marched upon Rocmoris.
Kantu?
Kantu groaned and rolled. A moment for the past to catch her. Ah, there it was. Like Lady White Skull, who calls you to the canals with her song and begs a ride upon your back. And halfway across the water, her bony claws dig in, and she drowns you.
Kantu!
The voice was nearer now, almost familiar. Her nose was clogged. Something congealed and unpleasant. She started to touch the mess of her face, but it felt strangely spongy, with a deep throb that reached the back of her brain.
Is it winter?
She muttered. It was dark and cold, a darkness and a coldness that ate at you. Not a desert darkness. Not the clean, crisp, starry dark of Belisar's nightfall. Wizardry.
The Fa.
Kantu remembered aloud. Goose flesh sprang to her arms. She made herself say it again.
The Fa came, and we fought.
The bird people had fought, but not against the Fa. Their battle was, and had been for years, against their occupiers, the Empire of the Open Palm. The Fa's arrival in Rocmoris had been an inadvertent blessing. His dark spell upon the city, their call to arms. No more desperate acts of midnight sabotage. No more skirmishes or staged protests. The time had come for the bird people to rise, rise up from the middens, up from the pimples, up from the catacombs beneath Pauper's grave. They rose up, armed with cudgels, torches, oil bombs. Three to a carpet they flew, bombarding the grand palace of Viceroy Erifet with fire and rage, taking out the houses and offices and barracks of the Audiencia lordlings. They flew, and they fought the rulers of the city, their invaders and oppressors. At last, at long last, after so many weary guerrilla years. And the viceroy's guards engaged them in the streets, bringing down the carpets with their nets, and the gate police came out with their spears.
Kantu?
Kantu tried to answer. Got as far as a croak. Her lips felt fat, crusted together, a pulsing purple ache. A quick breeze rushed overhead, along with her name in an urgent whisper. Kantu groaned louder, trying to be helpful. Rock-a-luck! A matter of seconds, and the sound of a velveted landing. Footfalls. Then a soft blue light, and Mikiel was there, with a ghost of a grin on her long, bony face, helping Kantu to sit upright.
Stupid, 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 hissed Mikiel. Manuwe said you jumped carpet.
Guy with a net, Kantu murmured. Taken us all down. You'd have done the same.
I would have dropped a brick on his head, Mikiel answered. Not myself.
Heat of the moment. Kantu paused. What's that light? Mikiel touched the glowing blue button on her shoulder. It flickered off. At another tap, it blazed up again. Kipped it off a childless man. Once the thaw marched in, his soldiers were everywhere. I just sort of swooped down and plucked it off one of them. Figured the thaw had plenty more in his chest of wonders. Why not ward the dark with borrowed wizardry? Because, Kantu thought, the wizard is a god, and all gods are vicious. She rubbed her bruised eyelids and tongued wincingly at the crusted coppery bits in her mouth. The weirdness of the witch light transformed Mikiel from best friend back to the alien thing she once had been. Her red hair seemed black as Kantu's own, but her skin, paler than quartz, turned almost transparent, and Kantu thought she could see to the bone. Mikiel did not hail from Rokmoris, nor any city, village, town, or tent of the Belisar Desert. She had been born in the north, farther north than the fountains and flowers and silver opulence of Kosvar, the king's capital. North even of Leveland, where the fjords ran deep as the mountains rose high. She came, she said, from the top of the world, from a land called Skakmat, where demons made their homes in flying castles made of ice. Mikiel's wanderings had taken her to every land imaginable, but it was in Rokmoris she decided to stay, 8 years ago, when she found the bird people and allied herself with their suffering. Kantu knew many of Mikiel's secrets, but not this first and deepest. Why Mikiel had remained. Only the Rokamama knew that. The Rokamama had adopted Mikiel into their raggle-taggle tribe, bunking her with Kantu in a subcell of the combs. Why? Kantu had thundered. All the sullen rancor and blistering jealousies that characterized the age of 17 roared in her words. She's a stranger, she's too tall, she talks funny. Because, Kantu, you are of an age and very alike. Yes, very. Both of you are headstrong and preposterous. Both of you, she sighed, still believe in justice. Well, she looks dead, drowned. She's so white. Then she'll compliment you well, my dark one. Be kind. She's come a long way. So Kantu, grudgingly, had taught Mikiel to walk the maze path of the catacombs, how to weave a carpet with thread that could fly, and finally, how to take to the skies. In turn, Mikiel showed Kantu how to dance with a knife strapped to her thigh, how to use a slingshot and flirt in 12 languages. For 8 years they lived and fought alongside each other. As unlike her in looks as Rokmoris from Kosvar, Kantu came to consider Mikiel her sister. Their hearts beat a twin tattoo on the Thunder God's drum. And now, in all the chaos of the uprising, Mikiel had not forgotten her. She found me, Kantu realized. Even in this darkness, she found me. As if Mikiel caught the thought, she grinned again, and her eyes sparkled. They were a limpid, pearly blue in color, almost white. Despite the witch light, she became herself again. You're dreaming, Kantu, she said. Too many blows to the head.
Just the one. Didn't improve my nose, I'm afraid.
That meat hook. The gods could not improve it.
Got any salt, Mick? Wanna grind it in a little?
Mikiel made to throw her arm around Kantu's shoulders. Her movement cast a strange shadow onto the crumbling alley wall. The shadow was taller and boasted more angles than even lissom Mikiel could account for. Leaning back, Kantu glanced from the shadow to the thing casting it and whistled through her teeth.
Huh.
You like? Crisione helped. She wanted to come, but it never would have carried three, so she went to scavenge food instead. Supplies are low.
Mikiel Maurice Athery, you are such a goddaft show-off!
Her friend shrugged, the mass on her shoulders bobbling.
It's just, we're all so scattered down in the combs. The Rakamama had no carpets to spare for finding your sorry carcass. I had to do something.
Her something had been to fashion a collapsible glider from the magic tatters and raveled rags of carpets too threadbare and patchy to carry riders. The contraption jutted up and out from Mikiel's shoulders like the great raptor roc mantling her prey.
It flies, she assured Kantu, sort of. You just have to talk gently to it, lots of encouragement, that's the way.
Kantu wiped her nose with the back of her hand, immediately regretted it.
It carries you, sure. Mick, a praying mantis, weighs more than you. Question is, will it carry two?
Come on, Kantu.
Mikiel neatly avoided answering by hauling Kantu to her feet. Every time she moved, it was a kind of dance, even weighed down as she was.
We can't stay in the streets. Too damned dangerous.
Wait, wait, wait a second.
Kantu cupped one hand to the back of her skull, the other to her forehead, trying to keep the world in one place.
Just tell me one thing, you demonic curse spawn of the north. Did we win? Is the city ours? Where is Viceroy Erifet?
Erifet? Mikiel laughed. Fled or dead? Who cares?
Gone. Gone with all his guards. And every lordly wormling of the Audiencia who had a camel worth riding. May they cross Belisar in safety.
Safety?
Of course.
Mikiel's smile was sour. Let them belly crawl back to Kosvar with cracked lips and swollen stomachs. Let Erifet confess to High King Vorst Vadalar that he lost the Empire's southern stronghold to the desert scum he swore to crush. And then, please the flying gods of thunder, let Erifet and the Audiencia sip of the High King's mercy.
As familiar as fear was the mercy of the Empire of the Open Palm. The broken treaties, the marches, the massacres, the prison camps and slave labor, the promises that oozed poison through honey-sweet lips. This mercy had the Viceroy Erifet shown the bird people during the 40 long and bloody years of his reign.
Kantu barked with laughter.
May Vorst Vadalar show him the same.
Heedless of her throbbing face, a wrist that was surely sprained, a broken toe, and countless contusions, she did a jolly little shuffle, puffing up dust from the gutter.
The Viceroy driven to the waste, Rock Morris ours.
Kantu?
Those two syllables would have flattened a priestess's mitre. Kantu stopped dancing. Every cut burned, every bruise clenched. She collapsed, panting, against the alley wall.
Why grim, Mick? She gasped, though she knew. Why, when the city is ours?
Well,
Mikiel gestured to the unnatural darkness. The wind moved with a black glitter, as though a billion tiny eyes traveled on it. Kantu could not smell the air, but she could taste it beneath the copper all the way down her throat, in the acids of her stomach, the way the air tastes of glass when lightning strikes the sands.
It's the thaw. The streets are overrun with childless men. They did not march into our city last night because Erifet called for help, nor do they seem interested in pursuing the Audiencia into the desert. but the thaw. When he came, he brought the night with him and its stays. He has already taken up residence in the Viceroy's palace. The parts we didn't burn. Citizens are being rounded up for questioning, and... By the milky blue light on her shoulder, Mikiel's eyes seemed wide as windmills.
And?
Kantu, a reward has been posted.
For whom?
For the Rokomama?
Kantu's hands fell to her sides, too nerveless even to form fists.
And for you.
They flew in slow, staggering stoops across Rokmoris. Once they had to land behind a small branch library to let Kantu alight and vomit. And again, after Kantu lost both her consciousness and her grip on the glider's handholds, she landed on top of a noxious midden out back of the Star and Crescent Tavern.
Mikiel said, worried, "We could walk?"
"I'm fine. This is faster. And safer."
"If that trash heap hadn't been there..."
"I'm fine, Mick."
They passed the high temple to Edgedenia, brightly lit against the unnatural night. Its corridors and courtyards teemed with refugees harried from their homes by the invaders and the insurgents and the panicked city guards. Kantu sent them a silent blessing. Let Edgedenia hold them, love them, calm them, keep them. Kantu had no quarrel with the lizard lady or her people. But Edgedenia was not her god, and Kantu had her own people to look to. They made a final, graceless descent over the barren mounds of Pauper's Grave at the southernmost edge of the city. After the mounds, the land ended in an abrupt cliff that sheared off into a dark crack of earth. This was the Fall Gate, the boundary of Rokmoris, the end of the known world. The black aperture ran across the desert, too wide to cross. Like many a blood-stained altar, this cliff was a holy place. Viceroy Erefet used to stage his executions there, at the very edge, proving once and for all that without their carpets, bird people could not fly. Beneath the mounds of Pauper's Grave, the secret burrows of long bygone builders spiraled down and down into the cliff rock. The labyrinth, the maze paths, the catacombs, where in secret the bird people dwelled. Kantu dropped from the glider with a wrenched groan, massaging the death grip out of her fists. Mikiel tumbled after, but regained her balance in an instant, shifting her feet lightly until once again her sandals settled like petals on the dirt. Kantu shook her head in fond disgust, but Mikiel did not notice. She was busy shrugging the contraption off her shoulders and folding it back into her pack. She stroked the patchworks and ribbing, murmuring sweet thank yous.
"Good old thing," she said. "Clever wings, clever threads, clever souls."
From beyond the glowing circle cast by Mikiel's blue button, Kantu spoke sourly.
"The rest of us get rugs. Rugs are good enough. They do the job. Only you would think of wings."
"And you call yourself bird people."
"Know what kind of bird you are, Mick? A snowbird. Northern fluff flying south for the winter."
"Caw!"
Mikiel deadpanned. Kantu blew a sore but profoundly wet raspberry at her. Laughing softly, Mikiel touched the blue button on her shoulder. The light winked off. For a moment, the two friends stood together, blind to each other and silent in the darkness. Something cold and fierce seized Kantu's hand. She gasped.
"It's just me."
"Mick, you're freezing."
"Nerves."
"Come here, my quivering ice maid. You and your thin, skocky blood. Put your arm about me.
You can hold me up and I'll warm you up. You'll find there's a distinct advantage to having feverish friends. Better than bonfires, really.
Mikiel twined her arm around Kantu's waist. Kantu leaned in heavily, close to collapse.
Easy on the ribs, Mick.
Lighten up, deadweight.
They were used to doing this part of their work in the dark, for only thus had the bird people kept the catacombs secret from their enemy all these years. They counted their paces across Pauper's grave, the tombs and mounds and trenches that stretched along the entire southern border of Rocmoris, until they reached a certain burial mound. It was wider in circumference but lower to the ground than the others. The first and the oldest tomb. Their doorway underground. As they reached it, Kantu's knees buckled. Only Mikiel's tightened grasp kept her from falling flat on her smashed face. Cursing, Kantu jerked to right herself. Mikiel grunted in sympathy.
No rest for the recalcitrant.
Kantu laughed, said,
Ow!
And sighed.
Kantu? What is the fa?
Kantu's stomach lurched. Pretending a distraction she did not feel, she knelt before the mound, padding around for the trap door. Her hand caught on the round wooden dial, which, dried and splintered from centuries in the sun, scraped her fingers. Dust and sand fell away. There, proud, the etched sign of the thunder god, the rock of Rocmoris, with her ragged wings shedding raindrops, and the diamond, bright upon her horned skull, shooting out lightning like a crown. The diamond needed no light to scintillate. It was older than the door, older than the tombs, the treasure of the bird people. No thief could pry it loose from the dial, nor could even the sorriest beggar sell it for her gain. The diamond had some magic in it, deflecting attention and desire from the doorway. When the bird people had fled to Pauper's grave in their hour of need, the diamond and the door had responded. Kantu closed her fingers around the dial, turned it, and started to haul.
The Fa, she answered Mikiel on a heave, rules Sanis all. That's the desert at the bottom of Belisar, east of here, hugs the coast. Not much plant life there, not even succulents. Very duny. We call it the Red Crescent for the color of the sands.
Yes, but...
The door creaked open.
I'll go down first, Kantu interrupted, since I seem to have a habit of falling on people tonight.
Grasping the top rung of the hidden ladder, she swung herself into a hole she could not see, that she knew by touch and memory alone, and climbed down three short rungs. Then she dropped. The drop was not a long one, but Kantu fell hard and forgot to roll. For a while she lay inert, breathing in short, painful gasps, as her eyes tried to focus on the triple entrance to the maze path. The first door led, eventually, to a hole in the ground that went down a mile and had bones at the bottom. The second, to a tunnel that wound around to nowhere for as long as you had strength to walk it, then stopped. The third braided its way into the rest of the maze and thence to the heart of the catacombs.
In just a few minutes, Kantu promised herself, this blackness will end. I will see my friends. I will see Manoue and Crisione and the Rocamama.
Mikiel dropped through the darkness beside her, irritated.
For once in your life, go slowly, Claudkin, if you haven't noticed, you're hurt.
She hauled Kantu to her feet, slung an arm about her, and propelled her toward the correct entrance.
Thanks, Mick. I'm just about done, I think.
I know. Kantu?
Yeah, Mick.
I know who the Fa is.
I just told you.
No, I mean...
Mikiel stopped and sucked air as if breath were her prayer for patience. Half of Kantu wanted to watch her friend's face. Half of her feared Mikiel once again igniting the blue light, its source, its possible sentience. Cowardice won. Kantu waited in the dark.
I mean, Kantu, Mikiel said slowly, I've been to Sanis'al. It was a year ago, on a scouting mission for the Rokomama. It's not nice. They're in a drought. Their crops and animals are failing.
Yeah, Kantu muttered. The rivers dried up when the rain stopped.
Mikiel pressed on. The army of childless men exists to protect the Fa and his wives, to guard the shiprock, and drive marauders from their borders. They're peacekeepers. They have never been interested in expanding their territory. Sanis'al was ceded to them by the gods. The Fa himself holds godright to the land. It's in his blood. He never leaves it. So why is he here in Rokmoris, with all his soldiers around him? Why did he bring the wizard knight? That's what I was really asking. Not who the Fa is, what he is. What is he here for? Why did he post rewards for you? My question is, Kantu, what is Fa Izif Banajur to you?
No one.
The lie sat like a live coal on Kantu's tongue. She wanted to spit it out, that it might light her way through the combs. But she swallowed instead.
I've never met him. He's just a story the Rokomama used to tell me when I asked what made the sun rise every dawn.
Within minutes of entering the heart of the combs, Kantu left Mikiel to the tender mercy of the carpet keepers. The twins immediately started scolding Mikiel for running off with their rag bags.
Miss Atheri, you know better.
Vishni reproached her with a sorrowful mouth.
You who've flown with us these 8 years.
No carpet, Rana spluttered, her color high.
Even tatty old ragged ones that no longer fly is to be treated lightly. They deserve respect. More than respect. Reverence.
But scolding turned to gasps of awe when they saw Mikiel's glider.
All those pieces? Rana exclaimed. Working together.
It flies?
Kantu heard Vishni ask.
Sort of,
Kantu murmured as she turned to go, smiling with raw lips. By the time she reached the threshold, Mikiel was flashing her stolen blue button around, chattering away about Crisione's design for the glider's construction and Mikiel's own daring rescue of Kantu. Kantu limped down the corridor to the surgeon's cell, hoping to be scrubbed, rubbed, bandaged, and sent to bed without further ado. She had not gone far before she started tripping on the cots and bedrolls lining the halls and wading through the wounded to get to Robin's cell. When she did, she found the surgeon gone, either on his rounds or for good, and his supplies scanty. The Rokomama, however, was there, tending a long spear score down Manue's chest. His back was to her, so he did not see Kantu at the doorway, and Kantu saw only the bones of his spine and the sharps of his shoulder blades, the blood that had dried his curly hair to spikes. The Rokomama, bending to swab out his wound, did not see Kantu either. Her bramble of frosted black hair had been tied back in a braid and covered with a kerchief. Her round face, usually dominated by a radiant and implacable serenity, had gone haggard.
She looks, Kantu thought with a rush of shock. Old.
The realization almost repelled her back into the hallway, back through the maze paths, back up into the enchanted darkness and the blood-soaked city above.
Surprise! she croaked instead, too tired for tact. Something in the Rocomama's rigid posture cracked. Her gaze flashed from Manaway's wound to fix on Kantu in the doorway, but the expression in her eyes did not change. Ghosts swam in the deep brown depths.
She thinks I'm dead, Kantu realized. She thinks I'm a spirit sending, a terrible shadow thing, coming back one last time to tell her I am no more.
The Rocomama's body shuddered and pitched forward. Manaway reached to steady her, turning slowly to look over his shoulder. His eyes widened at the sight of Kantu, and he whispered something swift and low to the Rocomama, who had hidden her face in her hands. At last, the Rocomama nodded. She raised her face and looked again at Kantu. Kantu surged into the room, making the formal sign of the Thunder God with her fingers. Her words burst from her lips as if she were a child.
You're not hurt, Mommy?
Of all the bird people who called the Rocomama mother, only Kantu was hers by blood. Usually it made no difference. Her voice ragged, the Rocomama replied,
Sore grieved, Pili, but sound.
Good, that's good.
You're whole? Still of one piece?
More or less. Finish up with Manaway. I can wait.
Kantu propped herself up against a wall while the Rocomama finished dressing Manaway's wound. Manaway watched her, his eyes tracking Kantu's gradual slide to the floor, where she slumped, eyes slitted with exhaustion, knees crooked to her chest. He was not a man to smile often, but he smiled now.
Last I saw you, he said, you were hurtling through the air. Had to meet a man about a net.
Kantu never could manage long sentences whenever Manaway smiled.
I saw what you did. Thank you. It was little enough. How many dead?
Grim again, and therefore easier to look at, he answered.
Hard to say. More than half of us are missing.
He recited the roll of absentees. Kantu felt each loss in her own skin, a thin slice of lightning.
And Crision Jean Erifet,
he finished.
Crision?
Kantu's mouth went dry. If Mikiel was her right hand, Crision was her left. The daughter of Viceroy Erifet, a princess of the Audiencia, Crision had grown up watching the bird people fly, both on their carpets and off the cliff. She had come to the Rocomama in secret one morning, clothed like a beggar.
I offer myself as blood ransom, she had said. Cast me from the Fallgate and have your vengeance.
And the Rocomama had kissed her sad face on the bridge of her nose, between big brown eyes as wide and wary as a wild antelope's. And she had said,
My vengeance is to love you. Can you bear it?
Crision,
Kantu repeated, swallowing. The floor moved beneath her like water, and before she could reconcile her own matter to this new consistency, she was on the table beside Manaway, with the Rocomama's broad arms wrapped about her.
Oh, Kantu, drink, drink. I don't know what you were thinking, jumping carpet. Noble self-sacrifice, Rocomama.
Kantu swallowed the infusion, which tasted of mint and a mild stimulant. The latter summoned the specter of her usual swagger.
With Manaway captaining, unaware we were doomed for net meat, and Ilya leaning so far off the fringe with his slingshot that a whisper would have flattened him, it was left to yours truly to act. You can't say I was wrong. Only look at Manaway. Alive, whole, our favorite weaver, bigger and beautifuler than ever.
Like most bird people, Manaway was small, with a short torso, wide chest, and a large, shaggy head that sat like a stone gargoyle upon his burly shoulders. He was too thin for his frame, and his skin was laced with scars. Though his features were unsubtle, his black eyes rarely betrayed a gleam of the thought behind them. He had watched his wife Inila step off the fall gate while Erefet smiled on. Her spirit, woven into thread by her widower, animated one of the swiftest, smartest, toughest carpets from which no careless rider could idly tumble. It had taken some clever maneuvering before Kantu could jump, untrammeled by that carpet's protests. It kept trying to buck her back to safety. They had been good friends, Kantu and Inila. Since Inila's death, Kantu had striven not to love her widower too dearly. Manawe stood now, squeezing the Rokomama's shoulders with his battered brown hands. She gave him a tired smile, scratching at her hairline beneath the kerchief. An unspoken question passed between them. "If you can," she answered, "don't overtax yourself." "It is owed," he reminded her. Sighing, the Rokomama stepped aside. Kantu was given no chance to concur or demur, for she did not realize his intent until Manawe had stooped close to cup her face in his palms. It was as if she suddenly had no face at all, was nothing above the neck but a nest of downy fledglings, soft and warm and restless with too many heartbeats. She had seen him coax mice and lizards and wrens to these hands, had seen him conjure the dead to his thread so gently that the carpets wove themselves for love of him. Now, beneath his hands, Kantu's swollen tissues shrank. Cuts closed, bruises vanished. With a click, her nose moved back into place, unhappily returning her sense of smell. The stink of her body, the dried sweat, the dried blood, the gutter where she had lain, the trash she had fallen into, all rushed into her nostrils and left her feeling dizzy and shabby with rekindled memory. When he was done, Manawe placed a thumb to the bridge of her nose and stroked down to the tip of it.
"All better," he said.
Kantu tried to swallow, found she could not.
"Did you make my nose any smaller?"
"Some of us," he told her, "like it as it is."
"For myself," said the Rokomama in her rollingest voice, which could incite in the timid and downtrodden such acts of bravery that poets wept to write of them, "I think it is a very fine nose, a splendid organ, a queen amongst olfactory instruments. You could travel the length and breadth of Belisar and never stumble by accident over such magnificence."
"Unless you fall face first into a cactus," Kantu parried. She grinned wryly at Manawe. "Thanks, friend. I owe you one."
"You saved my life, Kantu."
"My nose is larger than life."
He almost laughed then. She saw his broad, oddly bony shoulders move.
"Very well. No debt."
Fearful to twitch or breathe, lest his hands fall away from her flesh, Kantu continued to smile witlessly up at him, until a disturbance near the door caught her eye.
"Crisione!"
But Kantu had not slid off the table before the Rokomama seized her, dragging her back bodily and placing herself between Kantu and the door.
"Don't, Kantu!"
"What?"
"She's not alone."
Then Crisione spoke.
"To Tessere, High Princess of Sanisal, 13th wife and favorite of Fa'izif Ban Najur, God King of the Red Crescent, I give you good and loving greetings."
The Rokomama's grip had not lightened, but Kantu stopped fighting it.
Crisione's forehead bore a blue gem, a costlier twin to the button Mikiel had plucked from the childless man, though it glowed with the same eldritch light. It seemed to be embedded in her bone, for the flesh around it was raised and red, and spidery veins ran from the gem down her face and neck. Her chestnut hair was loose, but instead of lying silk straight as it usually did, it rose around her head, licking the air like flame. When she spoke, blue fire filled her mouth.
"That's his voice,"
Kantu whispered, remembering. Dreamily, drowsily, almost imperceptibly, Crisione's head turned, her attention shifting from the Rocamama to Kantu. Her familiar face, her lovely, dainty, friendly face, her tiny nose, keen audiencia cheekbones, shy mouth, eyes gone whimsical and nearsighted from too much scroll diving, her "I can outstubborn even you, my dearest friend" chin, her face, Crisione's face, was almost unrecognizable. Crisione was not in possession of herself. Kantu did not mean to move, but her head shook and kept shaking side to side. Tears spurted from her eyes, though nothing else in all that long, long night had made her cry.
"It's like staring into the sun," she thought, only to find it staring back.
"Tu Kantu Jean Izif Ban Ajour,"
Crisione continued, in a voice calm and deep as a cathedral bell.
"Handprint of the thunder god, storm bird, rain bringer, savior and sacrifice of Sanis all, I extend to you my heartmost greetings and this message. Return the life you stole from your people. The Fa, your father, begs you."
"No!"
shouted the Rocamama.
"My daughter is not for you."
"Return," said Crisione, "or I will raise Rocamoris to the ground. Woman, man, child, all within these city walls shall perish, crushed by freezing darkness. Their dust shall be swept from the Fallgate, and night shall lay forever across this barren acreage, that no one living will rebuild upon it, and no green thing grow within it for all eternity."
Kantu did stand now, though she had to cling both to Manawe and the Rocamama to keep her feet. Manawe's grip was no less furious, no less tender than her mother's, and Kantu knew this meant far more than she had time to understand. The Rocamama was wild-eyed, her knuckles white. Her large, lined brow was sheened with sweat. She looked capable of any atrocity.
"Mommy?"
Kantu touched a frizzled tendril of her hair, and the Rocamama shuddered again, like an earthquake of the bones.
"We can't run anymore, Mommy. We must go to him."
Kantu had one strong memory of her father. The rest she had built patchwork, like Mikiel's wings, out of things the Rocamama had told her. The memory was this. She was nearly 5, and the joy of the shiprock. She was let to run loose wherever her dimpled limbs could carry her, and it was general knowledge that, like a cat, she followed the sun, to play in its rays or nap in its warmth at whim. When her father was at the shiprock, she followed him, for the sun rose in his ankle and set in his eyebrow. Mommy said so. Everyone said so. Mommy was father's 13th wife and his favorite. The Fa kept her bed night sacred, shared with no other wife, and Tesserae was at his side most every day, his best friend and confidant. One night a week, the Fa took a rest from his conjugal duties
and this night, too, he spent at Tesserae's side. Often Cantu joined them on the Fa's enormous bed as they read to each other or talked softly over palace matters. The other modest women did not grudge Tesserae the Fa's partiality. Rather, they came to her for counsel, to mediate domestic squabbles before they escalated into feuds, or for comfort when they missed their families and homelands. Tesserae was mother to all the shiprock, it seemed, but never less than Cantu's own momie. One evening, perhaps for the first time, Cantu found herself alone with the Fa, her father. It was sunset, and they were standing on the roof of the shiprock, overlooking all of Sanis'al. They saw the golden domes of her father's palace, the graceful arches and promenades and flowering towers of the city, the painted rooftops, the warm white stucco, the rainbow mosaics tiling every sidewalk and street. Best of all, running through the city and out into the distance, were the mighty rivers Anisat and Canarac, serpents in the thunder god's claws, which brought fertility and abundance to the Red Crescent.
Do you like what you see, Pili?
Cantu smiled up at him. Momi was taller than the Fa, but he was as large as the sky. His face was painted gold like the sun, and his eyes were deep and black as night.
It is yours. It belongs to you as your godright, and you belong to it. Do you know why?
Cantu nodded, bringing her right hand to her left breast. Beneath her thin cotton shift, a red handprint burned across her skin, where the god had touched her in Momi's womb. The Fa had a mark very like it on his face, beneath all the gilding.
You are my daughter, he said, my beloved daughter. That mark sets you apart. Had you been born my son?
Here his voice frayed into sadness, and he looked away from her, across the scarlet sands.
But you are better than a son, he said, for if you were my son, you would be mortal, destined to bear the heavy mantle of mortality on your shoulders, the weight of living and loving, and knowing that all good will sift from your fingers like sand. Had you been a boy, at the hour of your birth, I, the Fa, would have died, and passed like breath between your lips, and lived again in you. She who had been your wife would become your mother, and you would have no father but yourself. From that hour to the birth of your heir, you would rule as Fa, alone.
But I am not a boy, exclaimed Cantu. This she knew, and she was proud of it.
No,
he said, smiling a little at last.
You are my beloved daughter. You are our hope, and you shall be our god. Do you understand?
Again Cantu nodded, although she did not.
In another month, on your birthday.
Cantu held up five fingers, like the handprint on her chest.
Yes, my love. When you turn 5 years old, we shall stand here on the roof of the shiprock, which is the tallest point of Sanis'al, and you shall fly.
The shiprock jutted from the sands, like a stone ship with stone wings, as if it had been abandoned by colossal seafarers in the days when Sanis'al was a kingdom of merpeople and Belisar was still an ocean. The volcanic breccia and igneous rock that composed the formation had been hollowed out and reinforced over the centuries by the mason artisans of Sanis'al, and now the stone was home to the Fa's 100 wives, their servants, and the army of childless men who guarded them. Cantu loved the shiprock, loved her desert, loved her father, and she took his slender brown hand and kissed it.
For one warm and splendid moment, his hand rested on her head. Then he squatted down, which he had never done before, to be eye to eye with her.
Kantu, he said, what I am about to say is most important. On the day of your birthday, you must come to this great height willing to fly. You must say to yourself, and to me, and to all the people who will be waiting below, this is my choice. This is my will. My life for yours. My blood for rain. Repeat that.
Kantu did. She said it until he knew she had memorized it.
And so, sighed the Fa, your sacrifice saves us all.
Not long after that, Momi came up and joined them. She kissed the Fa and smiled at him, kissed and smiled at Kantu, chatted lightly about the lustrous wheel of sunset, about the first shimmering constellations and the stories told of them, about nothing much at all. But Kantu saw, hidden in the folds of her robe, how Momi's fists were clenched like stones. Every bird person who could still walk ascended with Kantu and the Rokomama to the surface of Rock Morris. Crisione went before them, the blue nimbus that crowned her lighting the way. With the effortlessness of a shadow, Mikiel slipped in next to Kantu, saying in her deceptively mild way, "So the Fa's some kind of demonic ventriloquist, is he? Tough luck on Crisione." But Kantu, whose fear and weariness had rubbed her nerves to screaming sensitivity, caught the shark's glint in Mikiel's eye as she gazed at Crisione's unprotected back. It reflected the razored steel in her hand.
"No, Mikiel,"
Kantu said quietly.
"It won't hurt him, but it will kill her."
"She might thank me." Mikiel's pitiless whisper did not carry, but Crisione turned her head. She turned it, and kept turning it, until 1 degree further would snap her cervical vertebrae for sure, and Crisione said nothing, but something screamed beneath the blue-eaten fires of her eyes. The knife clattered to the ground. The bird people marched with Kantu and the Rokomama once again driven from their sanctuary. The walking wounded bore nothing but their anguish. Others carried carpet rolls upon their backs. The carpets whispered to one another, rippling like wind things, like water things. Some bird people carried those who could not walk, but who would not be left behind. Only a few remained in the tunnels, with heartsick volunteers to tend them. When the Rokomama had tried to convince everyone to stay, that the coming exchange was nothing to them, Manue stopped her.
"We have followed you for 20 years, Rokomama," he said. "Do not forget, this city is ours, and you were born of it, long before you became wife to a god."
"And mother of one," Kantu thought. Then,
"Not yet."
Men awaited them on the mounds of Pauper's grave. Hundreds of men, childless men, dressed in their vests of white bone, their red tunics that bared shoulder and knee, their sandals that laced up the legs. These were the sons of the Fa, and the sons of the Fa before him, all those who had been born without the red handprint marking him heir to the godrite. These sons had been given to drink a potion at their comings of age, which rendered them impotent, that they might never bear rogue wizard offspring in the fullness of manhood. They were at that time sent from their mothers to be trained at the barracks of the shiprock. They were lithe and lethal. Their faces were unlined, pure, painted silver as the Fa's was painted gold. They wore their hair unbound, beaded with glass and bone. Cantu realized they were all blood to her, brothers, uncles, great-uncles, hers. They stared back with avid interest. Some of them hated her, she could see. They blamed her for the slow death of the Red Crescent, the desiccation of Anasat and Canarak, the stupefying toll of people and livestock brought down by 20 years of drought and starvation. Others watched her like the bird people watched the Rocamama, as if she were all their hope, a gift from the flying thunder god to succor and aid them in their darkest hour. Cantu took a deep breath, but she could not smell the Belisar wasteland, the sweet smoky green of Kriaskeet, or the good dry desert sands that carried the musk of night hunters upon their particles. She could smell only her father's magic and his longing, the blackness of his despair coloring the air all shades of night, calling her to his side.
"I'm here."
Her voice, already rough from wear, broke. The ranks of childless men parted, and the Fa, her father, stepped forth. Fa'ezif Ban Ajur was not even as tall as she remembered him. Cantu matched him height for height, and even among the bird people she was small. His nose was like hers, a great curved hook, but with his piercing eyes, and the gilded planes and hollows of his face, the prominence gave him an aspect at once regal and forbidding, like a golden eagle. He was dressed in similar garments to his sons and brothers and uncles, only without armor. A long scar ran across his throat, and Cantu remembered what had made that scar. And she remembered that though she had thought to check Mikiel for a knife, she had forgotten the Rocamama.
"Mommy, no!"
She was too late. Tessere had broken free of Manue's grip and was rushing on the Fa, silent but savage, her teeth bared. A deadly crescent of sharpened bronze glinted in her fist. Cantu knew the instrument, knew every image etched upon its bitter edge, and the ancient lettering laying out the strictures of sacrifice. The Fa stood very still, watching his wife run to him. 3 childless men caught and held the Rocamama yards before she came within striking distance. Though each soldier was as sinewy as a mountain lion, not one of them handled the Rocamama with brutal or callous indifference. It was as if they believed they held a fanged butterfly or a hummingbird that spat poison. Whether this was because they thought Tessere herself dangerous or because the Fa still loved her, Cantu could not say.
"Tess."
Fa'ezif Ban Ajur stepped close to the Rocamama, close enough to pull the kerchief from her hair. Dark masses fell around her face and shoulders in tired clouds, webbed in gray.
"Every night," he said, "I dream of you."
At his gentleness, the Rocamama collapsed. Only the grips of the childless men kept her more or less upright.
"I killed you," she said. "I killed you, Iz. You cannot be here."
One of the soldiers handed the Fa the bronze dagger she had wielded. He stroked the edge with his thumb, his golden face absorbed.
"With this blade, you cut my throat on the eve of Cantu's 5th birthday."
His voice was dark and slow, like gore welling from a wound.
"And the blood ran out of me and into the soil of Sanisal. For a while it was enough. Even without the rain, my blood sustained the land. But without a son who bears the god's handprint, I cannot die.
And as my blood returned to me, and as my wounds healed, my land grew brown and withered. Years have passed, and I have allowed them to pass, but I cannot allow it any longer. Tess, without you, my heart is a wasteland. Without Kantu, so is Sanis all.
I will lay waste the world, said the Rocamama, for Kantu.
Our thoughts have always been twins, said the Fa, running in joyous parallel. But in this, we run cross-purpose, ramming together like two boulders. It is my lifelong sorrow. But I spoke you true through my handmaiden.
He gestured to Crisione, still haloed in blue.
Rock Morris falls tonight, if Kantu fails to fly.
Kantu stepped between her parents, vaguely aware of Mikiel and Manue tugging at her, of voices calling her name in protest. Her friends. These were her friends, who loved her, who had grown with her, fought beside her, laughed at her jokes, tended her scrapes, who had flown with her. Her friends, who with Viceroy Erifet now driven to the sands and the Fa eager to return to Sanis All, might at last be free. Tiredness seeped from her marrow. Kantu's sight whitened for a moment, and her body flashed on the visceral memory of falling. She had always loved riding the carpets, ever since Manaway's older brother, now dead, taught her the way of it. The tumble, the soar, the zip, the whirl, the joy and jubilation, especially when she was flying for flight's sake, not to escape the gate police or hound the audiencia.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.